You're listening to Getting Things Done, the official podcast of the David Allen Company, with David Allen speaking with Brian Robertson. Welcome everyone to Getting Things Done, GTD for shorthand. My name's Andrew J. Mason, and this podcast is all about helping you on your journey practicing the art of stress-free productivity. Today we have a fascinating, wide-ranging conversation between David Allen and Brian Robertson. They discuss the multiple common threads between getting things done and Holacracy. Today is also our 50th episode, and to celebrate, we're giving away 5 GTD workflow maps in PDF format. So to enter to win, tweet sharing your favorite David Allen quote, and be sure to include the hashtag GTD Summit. That's GTD SUMMIT. Winners will be chosen at random on June 6th, 2019. It's our way of celebrating and also saying thank you for listening for 50 episodes. And now, without further ado, here's David Allen talking with Brian Robertson.
And then David had just started saying something, and I was like, stop, don't say another word until I start the recording. So, David, can you repeat that and then let's launch in from there?
It's more about Brian and I have both been, I guess, from another planet to just sort of uncover something that needed to be discovered, recognized, formulated into some sort of a model that would allow us to engage in our planetary experience in a more elegant, highly evolved way. And we're not born doing that. So these things have such a resonance right now.
So what just came up for me listening to you was kind of this, just putting GTD and Holacracy in a much larger perspective, how we humans relate to our own attention and our own consciousness. And then thinking about, well, what changed, right? Yeah, we're still going to need in-baskets when we land on Jupiter or the moon of Jupiter. So I'm not sure Jupiter you land on, but right? Like,
when we land on Jupiter in 2090, you still need an in-basket. You still need to decide what's the next action. You still need to decide whose accountability is it to handle that and process that tension. And why are we here to begin with? So you and I have both been involved in that conversation in terms of developing a model for that. And though that seems so self-evident, it is so non-self-evident in most organizations and for most people personally.
But back in the Stone Age, yes, you still had stuff. You could still probably benefit from GTD, but the environment complexity was probably not so much that if you didn't have a good practice of putting your attention in what GTD does, you probably are just fine, right? There's not that much complexity.
But for some reason, they started to park things in some sort of external brain.
Almost seems to me like an evolution of our human development.
Why did people even start to externalize thought to begin with?
Right. At some point, it's like the biological brain is not the right tool. You know, I mean, the same reason we have computers and internet and hammers. I mean, any kind of tool, right? At some point, it's like the faster direction, pathway of least resistance for evolution is no longer in evolving our hand to be more like a hammer. It's creating an external tool that can be a hammer, because that's just way faster than trying to use biological evolution.
And I could hand you a hammer and you could do that pretty well, but I hand that to somebody who really knows how to do that really well. There is an expertise about the game we're playing.
It makes me think too, again, going way back, like at some point, thousands of years ago in human history, at least, maybe way before that, and we just only know about it from thousands of years ago, people started discovering meditation, right? Or they started like turning the mind inward to notice our own attention, our own meditation. And this happened in all different spiritual traditions in all different ways. There was this turning inward to notice, how does the mind work? You know, and to notice how attention tends to latch onto things and then quickly flit from thing to thing, right? And that gave rise to disciplines about focusing attention and noticing attention, and practices emerged from that that were very much, they weren't external brain kind of stuff yet. They were more like, just how do you stop the internal madness and chatter and be able to even stay present?
Or how do you survive on the savannah in the desert in your cave or whatever, based upon your knowledge of stuff that you need to see a larger context of where you are?
Yeah. And then fast forward, the way I look at what you did with codifying this GTD practice, to me is so similar, but when the complexity levels up, you have a world where it's not enough to just be in the moment responsive consciously and with presence. Now we actually have commitments that span across time and that we have to like track. We have more that we can just respond in the moment through presence with. And yet still underneath that, what GTD ultimately is to me is a practice for working with human attention and the nature of mind, just like meditation. It's just more significant. It's noticing there's different types of hooks for mind, different types of things that we might get stuck to, different relationships we can take to the commitments we make ourselves. But it's still like, it's almost a more evolved form of meditation in my mind that works across time, not just in the moment.
What's so weird to me is that the simple and yet subtle idea of what's on your mind, why is it on your mind, and what do you need to do so that it's off your mind, so your mind is clear. If you like your mind being distracted, hey, go for it. But if you like that sense of, I don't want that thing distracting me or worrying me or bothering me, what do I need to do about that? So figuring out that algorithm, and I think that's what I did with the whole GTD process, is figure out what's the algorithm that you need to apply to say, I need cat food, or I need a life. And either of those, if they're still on your mind, what do you do about those so that doesn't distract you from having this resource available to you, which is your intuitive intelligence? That's always available to you. But most people can't tell the difference between intuition and indigestion.
Yeah, I love that.
Because the complexity of those things that are still banging around in that part of your brain doesn't do that very well.
I think what you're hitting at, to me, connects to why I've noticed the people attracted to GTD. That's one of the things that strikes me again and again when I meet so many people in my world. The people attracted to GTD are some of the most spiritually awake, self-aware. I mean, so some of the most interesting humans on the planet. And by the way, quick plug for, I know you're doing a once every 10 year at this point forum, a GTD summit in June. And that's one of the things I'm most excited about it, is the kind of people that coalesce around this. And I think what you're describing now is partly why. It's, I mean, it's the same thing I intuited as I got into GTD, is that what this is, what you've done is find this algorithm that is fundamentally connected to how our awareness works, how our mind works, how our attention works, and what's needed to get to a space where we can show up in this clear presence. People that get that are attracted to that, tend to have their own significant capacities, or they wouldn't be able to see it when it was presented right to them. They wouldn't see what this is really doing. So the people that are most excited about GTD, I find, are often the ones that have these kind of capacities that are the kind of people I want to be around.
They know the value of system. They know the value of process. They've just overcreated past their capabilities to be able to manage that well. And so they know the next chapter about what needs to be there.
Yeah, I love that. The people who need it the least are the ones attracted to it the most.
Yeah. What you guys have done and what you create based upon this model, what's most surprising to you now about this in terms of what do we do with this?
You know, I think the thing that at this point in my own journey has me the most interested and excited about this and most drawn is when you have a clear mind, right? When you're able to clear the clutter, and I think GTD and Holacracy are both about that at different levels, it then opens space to the clear mind, almost a little metaphorical, allows heart to show up more and to integrate and enter it. So I can be so much more loving in the world when there's not a bunch of mental clutter distracting me. When I have clear mind, I can drop in to my heart space more and I can integrate them more. And I think that's what grabs me most in my own work with Holacracy right now. It's not just getting the clear mind organizationally or the clear space. It's what that then enables when it comes to now adding more heart into our organizations.
And at the same time, smarter. You need to have the space to be able to see the next version of how do we manage this biological medical thing we need to do to build people into home-based medical care. It's like creating a space for just much more intuitive intelligence.
Yeah. There's something when you have this kind of clear mind and the presence, and I just realized also clear heart. You've gotten through some of your own unconscious emotional triggers and patterns, and you have a clear heart and a clear head, then each one enhances the other, right? I find that in my organization, our warm, loving culture. When I have the kind of relationships within my organizational space where there's love and care and connection, that enables us to have better ideas together, better business, better results, like all of that stuff clear. And vice versa. When we have clarity, as you say, I love this quote of yours, if you don't mechanicalize the mechanical, you will mechanicalize your human relationships.
Right.
And when we have appropriately mechanicalized the mechanical and gotten it out of the way, right? We have mechanical processes to deal with all the mechanical stuff that we need to work together and have productivity together. Now we have clear space for creativity and for heart both, and then the two commingle. I don't know.
Again, to your last point, the idea that we sort of manage that level of game we're all engaged with, the late great Peter Drucker described knowledge work, having to define your work is your biggest work. And so define what that work is, what has our attention, and then what our work is about that is then a whole new sort of level of accountability and responsibility that needs to be trained and needs to be incorporated that we weren't born with.
And in a lot of ways, I mean, if you look at one of the challenges of Holacracy in that regard, it's asking people to get involved and do that kind of work of defining work at an organizational level. You're asking people to do organizational design, which is really asking people to get involved in work that typically in management hierarchy days, only the CEO did. And most CEOs don't do it that often and don't do it that well. Right? So it's an interesting thing. And that's one of the challenges of it, right? It takes building a new skill set, and yet one that I do think is a skill set we cannot rely on just a CEO or a leader at the top to do anymore. Our businesses are too complex. We need everyone to get involved in the work of defining the work or the work of defining the structure, defining the whole system. We need more people involved.
I'm just laughing, Brian, because, you know, in 2010, when you and I met and I heard your game, I went, this is the next level of game that has to be uncovered. And even back then I said, a 5-year exploration to prove this wrong.
You know, still working on that.
Get rid of it if this wasn't the right way to do it. And if so, implement it as best as possible. We're now like 9 years in, and I go, anybody out there listening or watching this, give me something better, a better model about how to manage what you just talked about, getting clear about what you're doing and the purpose, and then how do you structure the organization to be able to fulfill that purpose. Let us know. Brian and I are both be open.
Totally. And then, you know, so much of my attention is, you know, I've been living in that for a while now. And so then what, right? Like once you've got that, then what? Just like once you've got a masterful GTD practice, then what, right? What does that free you to do? And that's where I get back to this head and heart thing, right? Like for me, anyway, this might be different for other people's journeys, but for mine, the more I clear my mental clutter, the more I organizationally can show up in an organization that is deeply trustworthy. I can trust that this system is adapting and that everyone involved is leading their part of it. For me, that like frees me from the worry of like having to be the traditional CEO type of leader that's constantly, you know, stressed out trying to hold it all together. It frees me to drop more into, you know, more of my intuition, my heart, my, like all of those aspects of life and of business, and then bring it to the organization.
Let me then poke at you, Brian, a little bit about that. Because now you've got your publicity says 1,000 organizations around the world that are starting to bite into, chomp into whatever Holacracy means for them. But once they've got that integrated into what they're doing, that's the next level of game. Okay, once you've then defined a new way for an organization to be able to manage its structural OS, its operating system, to be able to do this, what do they do with that clarity? Yeah. How do they then manage that clarity process forward? And I think that's still something to be maybe digested, something to be chewed on, something to be looked at. Because I know you guys have tried to struggle with what's the best strategy context in terms of meeting structure. What do we stop doing? What do we need to do more of? Which is elegant. And I don't know that there's anything more forward than that. What's your thinking there? Is that a new frontier for you in terms of once people actually are here?
Great question. I was just reading yesterday a book on the history of a historical book on some of the founding of the United States and some of the early settlements and then the issues with Great Britain and just all of that stuff. And one of the senses I got was like this act of settling in North America at the time and then starting to carve out kind of new ways of being in this new land. And then the freedom that came from having the ability to colonize, to settle, to explore, to expand, the new economic options, all of that stuff. It was like this new world, and then suddenly this massive field of opportunity once this big act of like, we've gotten established on this new land, this new world was here. And I kind of feel similarly, once organizations really get through the power shift of Holacracy, which is where I would say, okay, now you've got this sustainable Holacracy practice, at that point, you've gone through this massive migration to a new world, right? You've colonized and settled this new land. And then at that point, there's this massive territory open. Do you go north and explore the woods? Do you go west and explore the mountains? Do you dig and start finding what minerals are in this new land? Do you plant crops and figure out what can grow here? And I feel like that with Holacracy, there's strategy, but there's also this in exploring authentic relating as a series of practices for the more human cultural space. We've evolved approaches to compensation, and that's a whole discipline, or firing. We have a firing process. I can genuinely say I love how my company fires people. And like all of these are new areas, and I don't see any one path. I see like we're in this new continent together now for anyone who's gotten here, and there's limitless exploration at this point. Just pick a direction and pick up your backpack and start hiking and see what you find. And that's exciting to me. I was just in India doing our first training there and talking to some folks there. And one of them was telling me how in his organization, Holacracy was helping break the old, you know, class system and how ingrained that was in India, to the point where one of the women that worked for him in a Holacracy-bound environment who came from the historical lowest class, her husband told her to quit the company, demanded she do it, because she was actually like getting these ideas about being liberated and empowered and all that. And she said, no, I would sooner leave you. And yeah, there's just so much. And so, you know, the guy that was telling me the story, he's using in that land of how do you change this historical roots in Indian culture with this. Another guy we're connected with is bringing Holacracy into prisons and was sharing recently there was a prisoner moved to tears just by the simple question at the end of a tactical agenda item, did you get what you need? He said nobody in his life had asked him with that level of attention, did you get what you need, and actually cared about the answer. You know, so there's that. There's, you know, my attention goes to some of these processes and apps, but there's so much. Wow, what can we do as humans together on this new continent, on this new land? And so I don't know that it's any one direction. I keep finding new people who are inspired and excited by new aspects of what they could do once they've gotten the baseline of power shift to Holacracy. It's probably similar with GTD. Once you get good with clear mind, like, what do you do? It's just opens up worlds for you.
You know, I'm still in that vacant space. Once I saw the success of getting things done, you know, I said, well, I guess I've handled this, meaning I'd put a manual out that the world could use in case I got run over by a bus. Somebody could pick it up and figure out how to do it. And then I said, well, I guess the rest of my life, we'd figure out how do we implement this? How do we get that out there to the world? So that's what I'm engaged with right now, age 73, and still trying to figure out, because that's not my expertise. How do I translate this? How do I get this out into a much larger audience?
I was hoping you'd tell me how to do that, because you've got more years of wrestling with that than I do. I don't know. I mean, I'm in the same question, right? I know when you really got the practice, I know it's profound and I know it unlocks new territory. What I don't know is how to get it out there enough to find the people that want to do it. And even then, even when you find the people that want to do it, it's still a challenge. I mean, it's a huge change. We're still learning, I think as a community, we're still learning how to really get companies there and how to get through this power shift in a way that is more reliable and more stable. But yeah, I don't know how to get it out. What I want to see for GTD is like, I want to see it taught in schools. I want everyone growing up to this to be as basic as like, you know, how do you relate with other people? Is how do you relate with your own attention, your own mind? Like that's just such a basic of being human to me. And I think Holacracy is similar. It's such a basic. How do we work together when we've got all these things coming up? We've got judgments of what's happening in our group experience. We've got desires or expectations of other people. And how do we take all these? And how do we get back to clear, aligned purpose together? Holacracy is a really basic practice for that. And then there's the trappings around it of how we capture the, you know, roles and accountabilities and all that. But at its core, right, it's just taking what happens when we show up in groups. We get frustrated with each other. We get frustrated with what's happening in the system. We have things we want to expect. We have things we want to control. We have things we want the freedom to go do and lead for our purpose, right? What do you do with all that to get clarity with each other so we're not stepping all over each other? To me, that's just such a basic of being human, in the same way that GTD is with our own interior consciousness and how we relate to our attention with our own commitments and our what we want to happen and to do and to achieve and, you know, all that. So these, to me, are basics, and I'd love them to be taught at that more basic level.
So what do you want the world watching or listening to this to know? What do you want to share with them?
What's coming up for me is explore, lean in. I'm not saying, you know, you should buy everything I say about Holacracy, make up your own mind, but there's a suspension that needs to happen. There's a counterintuitive nature of this. There's kind of a leaning into just trying something new. I mean, there's a lot of misinfo about GTD and Holacracy both out there. And then there's a lot that's more of a knee-jerk reaction from our conditioned ways of making sense of life or organization or whatever. And some parts of both are counterintuitive. Like I hear people all the time talk about GTD, like, you know, that say, oh, no, that's not for me. I'm a creative thinker. You know, I don't like lists. It's like, well, wait a minute. If you want to be a creative thinker, this is exactly what you need. This is for the creative thinkers out there, the people that want more space to be creative. And Holacracy is similar. It's like, hey, people, no, you know, I want more dynamic, right? Like more freedom in organization. And then Holacracy has all that structure. It's, no, you're missing it. And for me, there's a sense of like, lean in, try this. Just learn, give it a shot. GTD and Holacracy both. If you value being the kind of person that brings presence and consciousness and attention and open-heartedness to your work, to your life, this is a practice for you. If you're the kind of person that values working with others in a way that honors their power and honors them while still being powerful in your own right, then this is for you. Holacracy is exactly for the kind of people that often see something about it that freaks them out. And the same, I think, with GTD, there's a leaning in and a really looking at the core of what this is, because it's so human and it's so tied to the way for me, being an awake, conscious, present human, which I strive to be, you know, this is a practice for that. People ask me, what's my spiritual practice sometimes? Do I have a spiritual practice? And I say, GTD and Holacracy. And they think I'm joking. And I keep trying to tell them, no, this isn't a joke. This is the deepest spiritual practice I've ever encountered. It's relating to how do I be the human I want to be in the world? How do I show up with the kind of love and presence and openness and curiosity and creativity and purpose alignment? And yet the power that comes from having clarity within that, the strength that comes with that. You know, for me, it is the integration of head and heart, or at least the path for being able to really walk that challenge. So anyway, I'm getting all philosophical on us, but that's what comes up for me. How about you?
No, fabulous stuff, Brian. Thank you. Fun conversation. Anything else you want to ask of me or?
Yeah, actually, as we move into just kind of a final couple of minutes here, I thought that might be a nice segue to what's your hope for, you're doing a summit. I haven't done one in 10 years.
No, we said, look, I think it's time for us to let the world know the train has left the station about GTD. It's on. And at what level of game people decide to play in it, that's up to them. But it's not stopping. So anyway, I wanted to create a sort of maybe we should raise the flag again and let all the world know how universal this is and let all of the people who are in any way attracted to this game come together and say, we will create a world where there are no problems, only projects. You know, yes. I'm 73 and we now have partners around the world that are invested in our methodology. And I've got 25 people that are master trainers that I would trust that if I get run over by a bus tonight, they will keep this thing going. They get it. And it's powerful stuff. And it's eternal.
So what the sessions there, they're not just going to be better ways to track your actions or whatever, right? It's way beyond just, you've invited me. You're not looking for just very detailed GTD technical talks.
No, it's just about people who've bought into this, playing this in the nature of the game they're playing. They're playing very highly sophisticated, highly productive games that will then inspire everybody else there and around the world about how cool this is and how relevant it is. You need to play into this game in some way, shape, or form. And there's a whole lot of examples and case studies of people who have done that.
That's awesome. So it's going back to my point of the kind of people that are deeply attracted to this work are often themselves doing amazing work from the place that GTD gets you, right?
And my biggest problem is that these 40 plus presenters who showed up and said, yay, yeah, I'll play at my own dime. They're all people I'd spend a whole day plus with personally, just because they're so cool in terms of what they're doing and how they're doing it and who they are.
And the dates again, just for anyone listening that may be interested, it's June
2021
in Amsterdam. And
by the way, if you have a team of people, family, group, team, or whatever, this would be such an incredible opportunity. We've already found people who are buying into this because they want to bring their team before and after. Amsterdam is such a cool place to be able to hang out, do some stuff around this event for strategy, for whatever?
Yeah, we did that in my company last year, actually. We, for our own conference in Amsterdam, we brought our team to stick around for a few days in Amsterdam for a little team outing, and it was really amazing, and it's a beautiful city for it. And in fact, I'll use that opportunity to plug the week immediately after that, June 24th, we're doing a Holacracy training in Amsterdam. Somebody could come for the summit and stay for the Holacracy training if you want to see two new ways of relating to your own attention together and all sorts of inspiring stuff that stems from that. So cool. I look forward to being in your orbit for a while longer, David, and seeing you in June at the conference.
Once again, if you're interested in entering our PDF GTD workflow map giveaway, share a tweet with your favorite David Allen quote along with the hashtag GTD Summit. Speaking of GTD Summit, it's happening on June 20th and 21st, 2019, and it would not be the same without you. You can get all of the details by visiting gtdsummit.com. Well, that's going to do it for me, but until next time, my name's Andrew J. Mason, asking you, what's your next action?